Should Pennsylvanians behind bars be able to vote? And fall foliage comes alive for colorblind Pennsylvanians. Welcome to the Morning Agenda, WITF's daily news podcast where the only agenda is you. Good morning. It's Monday, October 14th, and this is being recorded at 5:45 a.m. I'm Karen Hendricks, sitting in for Tim Lambert, and I'll be your host on this daily trip around the region's top stories. Let's get started. Pennsylvanians in jail may be eligible to vote if they're not convicted of a felony. Tom Reese of our partner station WESA reports a Pittsburgh legislator wants voting rights to be clear for people behind bars.
Pittsburgh State Rep. Arion Abney wants his fellow lawmakers to ensure people in jails can vote if they're eligible. And many people sitting in county jail haven't even had trials yet. Abney and other Black and Latino lawmakers visited jails in Allegheny and Center counties this summer, seeking to learn about their voting procedures. Advocacy groups consider those facilities, quote, good models for voting policies. Abney says many other jails only provide minimal information to detainees. He praised the Department of State for recently distributing new instructions to prisons and jails.
I think most of them are open to it and receptive to it. I think they're looking for direction. I think the guidance that Department of State just produced is going to be a good first step.
So far, those efforts are voluntary.
That was Tom Reese reporting. Meantime, a House bill that requires jails to expand voter education has been bottled up in a Democrat-controlled committee. Medicare's annual open enrollment period gets underway this week. It's a chance for people 65 years and older to look at new health insurance plans and make changes to their coverage for 2025. Nicole Leonard of our partner newsroom, WHYY, spoke with Medicare counselors in Pennsylvania to gather helpful tips for participants.
Nearly 5 million people in Delaware, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania are eligible for Medicare, which is a federal health insurance program for adults 65 and older. There are a lot of different medical and prescription plans to choose from, so reviewing them all can be overwhelming. Glenda Radical and her team of Medicare counselors in Delaware County help assist people through this process. She says, first, it's really important that all enrollees look at new plans, even if they're happy with the one they have now.
Everything might be wonderful, but if you don't check to find out what the cost is from year to year, you can hold on to a plan that, you know, could be very expensive going into the forthcoming year.
Radical says people should also confirm that their plan will cover the doctors, specialists, hospitals, and medications they'll use in the coming year. Medicare open enrollment runs from October 15th through December 7th.
That's WHYY's Nicole Leonard. Penn State's Students for Justice in Palestine group hosted a week of action on the University Park campus last week. Events commemorated the one-year mark of the Hamas-led attack on southern Israel and the beginning of Israel's bombardment of Gaza. Sydney Roach of our partner station WPSU reports from the Hub Robeson Center lawn, which was covered with thousands of white flags last Thursday.
Rua Doss is a third-year graduate student. She's on the executive board of Students for Justice in Palestine.
We have 18,600 flags on the Hub lawn today. Over the past year, Israel has murdered what is estimated to be at least 186,000 Palestinians in its genocide in Gaza. All of these flags that you see, 18,600, every single one represents 10 different people that have been murdered by Israel.
Gaza's health ministry said Wednesday the Palestinian death toll is about 42,000. But a study published in the Lancet Medical Journal estimates the real number could be closer to 186,000 when indirect causes like disease and malnutrition are counted. Doss says these flags help students visualize the loss of life in Palestine. She also hopes to pressure Penn State to divest from any companies that profit from war, and she says she wants to get the university to stop doing weapons research at its Applied Research Laboratory. The lab gets funding from the U.S. Navy.
Our university is complicit in the war industry. It kills people in order to make profit. And so that is the last thing that we are trying to communicate, that we as students on Penn State's campus have power, and we have power to further the liberation of the Palestinian people and of oppressed people worldwide.
Students for Justice in Palestine will cap off their week of action with a vigil on the Old Main Lawn Friday night. Penn State Hillel, a Jewish student life organization, held its own vigil on October 7th to commemorate the one-year anniversary of the Hamas attack in Israel.
That was Sydney Roach, and students capped off their week of action with a vigil on the Old Main Lawn Friday night. And new color-correcting viewfinders are in place at 9 state parks to help colorblind visitors see fall foliage. The lenses filter light to increase contrast to address symptoms of red-green color blindness. Around 1 million Pennsylvanians are colorblind, according to the state, and that includes Governor Josh Shapiro, who got to try one of those viewfinders at the Black Moshannon State Park in Phillipsburg last week.
Today we got to see the beauty of it and really how different it is. And for me to be able to see the different color in each leaf was just extraordinary. It's like mind-blowing.
Shapiro says these viewfinders are part of his campaign to encourage tourism. Outdoor recreation adds $17 billion to Pennsylvania's economy each year, according to the Shapiro administration. The color-correcting viewfinders are also in place at Bald Eagle, Heiner View, Kettle Creek, Little Pine, and Cinnamohoning State Park. A 10th viewfinder will soon go into place at Tyodotten State Forest. This morning, I went through about a dozen news sites in central Pennsylvania and found a few stories to put on your radar because they cover issues that may impact you and your community in the future. Here's what I discovered today. A retired Lancaster City police dog has died days before his 10th birthday. Canine Striker dedicated 3 years of service to the Lancaster City Police Force in the areas of narcotics and patrol. He's spent the past 5 years in the home of his handler, who adopted him following his service. Striker's death comes nearly 8 months after retired canine Zoltan died at 9 years old following a battle with cancer. There are currently 4 dogs on Lancaster's canine team. The most recent addition was 17-month-old purebred German Shepherd Mizo. And people are still talking about the stunning skyscape they saw across Pennsylvania last Thursday evening when the northern lights were visible. The phenomenon, which produces pink, purple, green, and blue hues in the sky, is known as an aurora. And space weather forecaster Sean Dahl tells the Associated Press the Northern Lights show may go on. Dahl says we remain in the grip of geomagnetic storms that aren't likely to fade until early 2026. He said last Thursday's storm generated a particularly vibrant display because the orientation of the storm's magnetism lined up well with the Earth's magnetism. And a Northumberland church is donating $10,000 to support disaster relief efforts in the wake of Hurricane Helene. The Unitarian Universalist Congregation of the Susquehanna Valley voted unanimously in favor of the funding, according to the Daily Item. The Reverend D.C. Fortune says he's proud of his congregation since the church only has about 85 members and a frugal annual budget. He said the gift, which will go southward to help those victims, shows the little church can punch above its weight. Now let's dive a little deeper into a story that hit our radar. When it comes to climate change, cars and other forms of transportation are the largest source of carbon emissions in the U.S. The Allegheny Front's Julie Grant takes a look at how the transition to electric vehicles is playing out in the presidential campaign.
Republican presidential nominee Donald Trump has been running an ad in the swing state of Michigan, home of the U.S. auto industry, that begins like this.
Attention, auto workers. Kamala Harris wants to end all gas-powered cars. Crazy, but true.
Trump makes similar statements on the campaign trail. Here he is at a rally in North Carolina in September.
Detroit will be wiped out within 2 years. You watch.
He warned that if he loses the election,
you won't have auto workers. The auto workers will be gone because all the electric cars are going to be made in China. I will end the insane electric vehicle mandate.
First of all, there is no EV mandate. Democratic nominee Kamala Harris finally addressed this recently at a campaign rally in Flint, Michigan.
And Michigan, let us be clear. Contrary to what my opponent is suggesting, I will never tell you what kind of car you have to drive.
The Biden administration is trying to move the auto industry toward more electric vehicles. Earlier this year, the EPA finalized a tough tailpipe emissions rule to ensure more than half of new cars in the U.S. would be hybrid or all electric by 2032. But so far, EVs are less than 10% of the market. Harris blames Trump for failing to help transition the auto industry during his presidency.
And when it came to building the cars of the future, Donald Trump sat on the sidelines and let China dominate.
Trump did impose tariffs on Chinese electric vehicles during his presidency. Biden quadrupled those tariffs to make the industry competitive. Now Trump is campaigning on doubling that again. His ad blames auto industry layoffs under the Biden administration on the push for electric vehicles.
And Michigan auto workers are paying the price. Massive layoffs already started. You could be next.
But are there actually fewer jobs involved in making electric vehicles? When Turner Cotterman, energy and automotive strategist at McKinsey & Company, was a PhD student at Carnegie Mellon University a couple of years ago, he was on a team that wanted to find out. They collected data from automakers, parts suppliers, and battery manufacturers and analyzed all the process steps.
We found that it took many more worker labor hours to produce an electric vehicle than it did an internal combustion engine vehicle.
But while the jobs to make gas-powered cars are largely in vehicle assembly, the CMU team found that many EV jobs are in battery making. The Biden-Harris administration got Congress to pass the bipartisan infrastructure law, which is helping to bolster the U.S. battery industry. Joe Sachs is executive director of the EV Politics Project, a bipartisan effort to understand the growing divide between Democrats and Republicans over electric vehicle adoption. Sachs wants Harris to move the conversation away from climate change and EV mandates.
And instead focusing on the fact that these products create really good jobs in these communities.
Harris has touted a $500 million grant to General Motors to convert a Cadillac plant in Michigan to electric vehicles, ensuring 700 jobs. This is something Trump's running mate, Senator J.D. Vance of Ohio, called, quote, table scraps in comparison to the auto industry job losses he expects if Harris wins in November. The United Auto Workers Union has endorsed Harris. Sachs says that if Trump wins the presidency, it could doom the tailpipe emissions rule and laws like the bipartisan infrastructure law and the Inflation Reduction Act that are funding EV charging stations, battery plants, and consumer tax credits.
We're worried that, you know, bashing EVs is good politics, and it creates a permission structure and incentive structure to do things like repeal the IRA incentives and to run on anti-EV policies. And we just want to push back against that.
Because Sachs says that would set back the transition to cleaner vehicles for years. Instead, he wants a narrative that electric vehicles are popular, that infrastructure is coming, and that American auto industry jobs depend on it.
That was Julie Grant from our partners at the Allegheny Front. And that does it for The Morning Agenda, a daily news podcast from WITF, where the only agenda is you. If you're enjoying The Morning Agenda, please subscribe in any of the places where you find your favorite podcasts, then rate us and let us know what you think in a review. Feel free to recommend us to a friend, too. Sitting in for Tim Lambert, I'm your host, Karen Hendricks. Be well, enjoy the rest of your day, and we'll talk again tomorrow.